shut it down. What a way to end, right? Grab a seat. Good to see you guys. I want to kick things off with a quote from Hall of Fame coach Vince Lombardi. He said, "Leaders aren't born, they are made, and they're made like anything else through hard work." Very good quote. I agree with it. I think how that applies to us, though, we're not making football players. We are making disciples, and we actually are made more and more into his image, and it's through the hard work of the cross and the work of his Spirit in us. But leaders are born by being born again. Amen? This is so key and so crucial. We are commanded to make disciples. We want to make disciples that make disciples that make disciples. But and here's what is a travesty is so many, we show up, we look busy, and that's discipleship. We think that's what it is, but that's not, we don't just show up. I mean, without work, if you were working, at the Ford company, you just, let's show up, let's look busy, you know. No, there's an assembly line, there's a plan to make cars, right? And we're not called to make cars, we're called to make disciples that make disciples. And so that we got to have a plan. We don't just show up and look busy, sing loud and proud, and then do it again in a week. We want to be a family because God is our Father. We want to be missionaries because the Holy Spirit has been a missionary to our own hearts. And so we want to make much of Christ, be in the city for the city because he's for us. And this is why we are here. And there's so many that are lost, so many that don't know that. It's key that we're making disciples because there is a battle at hand. There's a battle for souls. This life is dangerous. We see it in our passage. A group of people tell Jesus about this terrible mass shooting that has taken place at a church. And not a mass shooting, but a mass slaying that takes place. We see it in verse 1. I just said shooting because I wanted to grab your ears. You're like, oh, another shooting. It's not a shooting this time. It's a slaying, and it happens in a church. Verse 1. I'm going to read it out of the NLT this time. About this time, Jesus was informed that Pilate had murdered some people from Galilee as they were offering sacrifices at the temple. So they're at a church, right? You didn't think going to a church would be hazardous to your health. I want to give you some background. Pilate, a lot of times you think of Pilate, he's a pretty nice guy. Him and Jesus, they have some interactions before his crucifixion. And man, it seems, Pilate respects him. In fact, washes his hands of it. He's like, man, I see this guy blameless. So you're kind of like, oh. Pilate is a nice dude. He's a nice guy. He's the Roman governor over the region of Galilee and specifically stationed in Jerusalem. Seems like a pretty nice guy. If you watch The Passion, you're like, okay, not a nice guy. Maybe nice to Jesus a little bit, but again, he's the guy that signed off for the crucifixion to happen. And then here, just this Roman governor allows for these people that are going into the temple to worship. Imagine they got their wallets out, their debit card, they got it stationed, they're zipping it through the giving kiosk, or they got their checkbook out, or they're serving in the nursery, they're handing out bulletins, they're trying to give. That's what we see in the text. They're trying to give. They're in church to give. I mean, there should be their special covering over them, right? Why did God allow for this? These guys are giving. I mean, when you get your wallet out, isn't there like this special umbrella from heaven that protects you and shields you? No, there is not. There is not. Living in this world is dangerous. Life is dangerous on this planet. You can't do anything without the potential of disaster. I've tried pickleball with my wife. Almost died. I did. I've done football. I thought football was that's a contact sport. Playing pickleball with my, racquetball. Although we've done, racquetball. Deadly. With my wife, deadly. So this life can be deadly. The racquetball, even if people playing racquetball can fall over and die. Making snow forts and snow angels, not hazardous to your health, but driving on the ice and this snowpocalypse can be deadly. Can be deadly. There's been so many that have died, even just this year in the West. Living in this world is dangerous. We got boating accidents, car accidents, airplane and bicycle crashes. You got heart attacks and house fires. And then there's terrorism at airports and theaters, schools, and even nightclubs. Nothing is safe from disaster. I hope you're listening. Just in this church alone, we have people that are living on borrowed time. Think about it. Think about it. I'm talking about my dad. There's more that have died and come back to life, just even in this church. As you guys know, a couple months ago, my dad went in for a knee replacement surgery, had a weird reaction to the anesthesia, and died on the operating table, clinically dead for 4 minutes. So and then came back to life. So in the span it takes a star athlete to run a mile, about 4 minutes, that's how long he was dead. How many would be okay with dying for 4 seconds? You know, like, who wants it? But how about 4 minutes? And he comes back with no brain damage. I'm able to prove that. I have played Pinochle with him. He plays very well. And he's wittier than ever. How does that happen? Just amazing. My dad is living on borrowed time. I'll keep going. A handful of women, sadly, have suffered with tubal pregnancies that have gone awry. And even my wife, 2 years ago, bleeding on the inside, should have died living on borrowed time. And then the last example I give you, a dear friend, she was at the first service. I didn't get permission to share her name, but I got permission to share the story. We know her well. Active leader in the church, was shot at in the face in a bathroom. She said about the size, I mean, just small, close quarters by a drug dealer, aimed the pistol at her face, pulled the trigger and missed. And then got distracted, the like doorbell rang or something, and she was able to get away. Just remarkable, our friend there, living on borrowed time. But this is what I need you to listen to. Aren't we all living on borrowed time? I'll prove that to you. The wages of sin is? The wages of sin is death. And yet, we're all here living on borrowed time. And in fact, I think of time. Time is in a sense, it's our enemy because we're made for eternity. So I don't know about you, I don't like time very much. We're meant for eternity. And so praise God, we can look forward to that. But on the other side, on the flip side of time, it's not our enemy, it is God's grace. On the other side of it, we see, man, that God in his common grace would give us time to repent. And so we see this sense of urgency to repent, to turn to him. And he would give us time to repent. If you're here and you're able to hear me and you're not tuning me out, checking your email or whatever, you can actually hear me. It is God's grace that you can hear from his word, that you can hear Jesus calling to you. Now, one might say, why is there so much disaster? I would rather ask, why would God give us second chances and third chances? And when God flooded this earth in the most cataclysmic way, the earth had never, even to this day, has not been shaken up like it did in that encounter. Why didn't he just flush the toilet and be done? Why didn't he just flood the earth and be done? Why would he have an ark? Why would he allow a second chance for mankind? He knew full well that sin was getting on the ark. I'll prove it to you. Noah, he knew full well, God foreknew that Noah would plant a vineyard. There's nothing wrong with planting a vineyard. There's nothing wrong with drinking a glass of wine, but there is something wrong about getting drunk. He got so drunk and naked like a frat boy on rush week. And God saw in his infinite wisdom and in his mercy to still allow Noah and his weird sons and family to get on the ark. But even some of you here, sitting here today, are like, well, you know, I'm alive because I'm a good person. God really just sees fit to see my awesomeness. Kind of a big deal. Okay, that's why I'm alive, which is so dangerous. So dangerous. Do not believe that. Job 1:21, and he said, naked I came from the mother's womb, and naked shall I return. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. is we need to know. I mean, we have four children. We have a couple children we'll meet in heaven someday. The Lord gives and he takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. He's good all the time. And we have to trust his plan and not look at the disaster, but look at the relief, which is the gospel. Jesus starts this theological discussion on disaster by posing this question. It's out of Luke 13 and verse 2. And he answered them, "Do you think that these Galileans were worse sinners than all the other Galileans because they suffered in this way?" Jesus's point, he's getting it across very extreme, that everyone is on borrowed time. Everyone is going to die, and that those that are alive are on borrowed time. And it's in God's sovereign plan and mercy that those that he gives any time at all, it's his mercy. It's his love. If we can hear him calling us, it's his mercy. We have to believe that. But again, what will you do with the fact that you've been given, that we've been given borrowed time? What will you do with the time you've been given? I want to share this with you. I had some time on Friday evening. My wife went out with another girlfriend, and so I'm just alone at the house, and I got my PJs on and slippers, and I'm gonna veg out on a little Netflix. That's what I'm gonna do, like you know the rest of you. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm not hating on that. But the Lord just hit me so hard by His grace, and I just when I'm in His presence, like sometimes I'll like just be overjoyed and start laughing. Sometimes it's crying, and I was weeping before the Lord, just seeing things differently. It was just amazing. And then He put this insatiable passion on, and even vision on. I need to do this. And there was 11 different documents I started. I talked to my wife. I was like, I got more done in these 2 hours than I do on vision and dreaming than I do in like a year. Just in 2 years. Now, some of you are like, "Oh, Josh, man, I'm so proud of you. That's our pastor. He's a hard worker." No, I'm a lazy slob that wanted to just turn on Netflix. But God in His infinite grace, that's grace, the divine influence on the heart that He'd get me off my butt and get me to work in for His kingdom. And I'll tell you what, I rested as I worked, knowing God is at work in me. And that's what He wants to do. And Jesus is trying to get across, man, if you're not seeing that fruit, you're not seeing God work in you, do you even know me? That's why He's crying out to repent. Some of us, we're just content to show up and look busy. Yay, Jesus. Jesus is so proud of me because I showed up early. I handed out bulletins. I wrote a bigger tithe check this week. I gave more than I've ever given. I'm even serving in the nursery. I prayed for Pastor Josh. He needs it. So God must love me more. Luke 13 and verse 4, or those 18 on whom the tower, this is not the Twin Towers, this is not the towers in New York, different tower, whom the tower in Siloam fell and killed them. Do you think that they were worse offenders than all the others who lived in Jerusalem? No, I tell you, but unless you repent, you all likewise will perish. Some of you said, well, when I was a kid in vacation Bible school or in the Awana program, I was, 6 or 9 years old. I prayed the sinner's prayer. I'm good to go. Maybe you heard Romans 10 and verse 9, powerful passage. And if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is the Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Man, I prayed that prayer. Jesus is my homeboy. Forgive me of my sins. There we go. I confessed and I believe. Good for you. You believe God is one. Good for you. Even the demons believe that and shudder. Now, the demons will not confess that Jesus is their Lord. In fact, he is their enemy. That is the difference between us and them. But how many of us have just prayed a flippant prayer that we didn't mean, we didn't allow the Holy Spirit to work in our heart, and there's not regeneration, there's not repentance, you're not practicing repentance? I'd ask, are you like this tree? How many of with OCD have been bothered all service with this tree? First service was honest. There was a lot of hands. Come on. Who hates this tree? How about when I get real close to it? How many of you are just bothered right now? It's gonna poke your eye out there. Yeah? We're like this tree though. I know it's not a fig tree, okay? But we're a lot like this tree if we don't know Christ. I mean, if you plug in this tree on Christmas time, I mean, you saw it line the backstage. It's actually kind of pretty if you plug it in. But it's just kind of boring. And that's the point. I know it's not a fig tree, but there's no fruit on this tree. It's wasting space. You want it to go. And we'll read it. Let's get into it. Luke 13:6-9. And he told this parable. A man had a fig tree planted in his vineyard, and he came seeking fruit on it and found none. And he said to the vine dresser, by the way, side note, vine dresser, I believe, is a picture of Christ. Okay, and the owner of this vineyard is God the Father. And we see right after the resurrection, Mary runs to, and she goes and discovers, oh, Christ is not here. She's in the garden. And who is behind her? The gardener. She thought it was the gardener. It was Christ. So he said to the vine dresser, look, for 3 years now I have come seeking fruit. Now, this is the... I believe the owner speaking to the vine dresser, look, for these 3 years now, I have come seeking fruit on this fig tree and I find none. Cut it down. Why should it use up the ground? And he answered him, sir, let it alone this year also until I dig around it and put on manure. Now, some of you are like, thank you, Pastor Josh, for not bringing manure into here. But it's very interesting that the vine dresser, I think is a picture of Christ, is saying, give it more time. But that same vine dresser, Jesus Christ, that is the epitome of love, is also going to come not just as a lamb, but he's going to come as a lion that will say, no, cut it down. You're right. See, some of us, we think we can show up to church and look busy and be a spectator and that God's okay with that versus a gladiator for him. Man, if you are not a gladiator for him, if you're not a disciple for him and you're not seeing fruit, do you know him? Because if you're grafted into him, if you're plugged into him, you're gonna produce fruit. Now, it might be a little bud that only you see it. I mean, you're like, do you see this? No, I don't see this. Well, you know what? I'm not here to please you, but God is doing a work. It's a small little bud right now. God's at work. Are you seeing fruit in your life? If you're not, you're going to be really frustrated. I mean, you can try really, really hard to work and get fruit on this tree. We could even spread some manure down here. Is it going to produce fruit on this tree? It's going to stink up the stage. We got to be grafted into his tree. See, this is the wrong tree. It's the wrong tree. It doesn't work. We need to be grafted into him. And so many of us, we look busy. Man, we're working every day. We're doing this. Or no, I said every day. I meant to say once a week. On Sunday for an hour, we do this. Man, I'm busy. Come on now. And we wonder why there's no fruit. It's interesting, listen. This tree is living on borrowed time. What are we going to do? I really believe that fruit comes from allowing God to have your heart. Look at this, Ezekiel 36:26. And before I read this, this is one of my favorite verses out of the Old Testament. Very, very powerful. We see the gospel even in the Old Testament. I mean, pictures of it. Every story whispers his name. Can the most expert heart surgeon in the world do surgery on his heart? Can he save his own life? He's got a doctorate in heart surgery. Can he save himself? We cannot save ourselves. We need God. We need his Holy Spirit to help regenerate us and call us and woo us and bring us into his arms. And he has to do the heart surgery. Look at it. And I will give you a new heart and a new spirit I will put within you. And does that excite you? Look at what God can do. But how do you know that he has done heart surgery on you. Look at Matthew 3 and verse 8. Bear fruit in keeping with repentance. There should be fruit. There should be fruit. If you're having to, out of obligation, give, or you're having, I got to show up. I got to sit in someone's living room and do this gospel community thing. Oh my goodness. Bunch of yahoos here, but I guess I'll do this thing because, you know, God, I guess, was into this whole thing. Jesus started the first gospel community with his disciples, a bunch of yahoos, so I guess I'll do this too. There should be fruit where, friends, listen, that when you're in this gospel community, you're in this worship gathering, you're in DNA with others, that even your perfectionism in you that sees the problems with the group that God has called you to, or even the problems in your marriage, instead of hating your wife or hating your husband, instead of just hating on the people in the church and seeing the hypocrisy, instead of being impatient with people that just show up to your gospel community, they don't contribute with the meal, they're just wasting space on your couch. Instead of seeing that, you start to love them and you start to pray for them and you start to look for opportunities to disciple them. Man, that is the fruit. That's the fruit I'm talking about. Or instead of just fighting with your spouse, you start to fight for the marriage. You guys want to check out an awesome passage, man? Psalm 119. Check it out. Psalm 119. Please, I hope you're listening. Write this down. Psalm 119 and verse 36. Listen, incline my heart to your testimonies and not to selfish gain. Turn my eyes from looking at worthless things and give me life in your ways. Notice, someone say incline. Say it. Come on, you didn't say it. Say it and mean it. Incline, go. Incline my heart. That tells us it was reclined. It wasn't inclined. It was reclined to what? To worthless things. It's right here, guys. It's in the text. Your proclivity and default settings is to be a lazy slob. You are a slob naturally, and so am I. We want to be, we want worthless things. We want to be reclined. We want a pastor to spoon feed and do all the work. We want that. That's our default setting. And so we see this great cry, incline my heart. Again, I want to share this. My wife is got the crock pot going at home. You put the setting to, what is it, hot or cook or something like that? High, that's what it is. Thank you, Faith. Set it to high and you walk away. You don't have to incline it or recline it or set it. I mean, it's already set. And some of us, we want that with Christ. We want to just set it and walk away. Like we did when I was a kid. I saw the puppets. I saw, man, I met Jesus. And praise God, maybe you did. That's awesome. But some of us were like, I set it. I set it to high. When I was 9, boy, I loved him. What's the fruit that he's brewing and cooking? Some incredible love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, gentleness, self-control. The fruit is their fruit. What we need to do is, through the power of the Spirit, because we can't do it, but set it, check it, check it again, set it, recheck it, set it. God, I put my unbelief, check it, recheck it. I mean, Lord, I don't know if I'm in the right spot. I need a new tree, or I need some manure. What did you learn today? Huh? Some of the manure in our life is trials, and we see the trials can grow us and strengthen us and sharpen us. Listen to this, Acts 26 and verse 20. I preached first to those in Damascus, then in Jerusalem and throughout all Judea. You can see it up on the Sky Bible. Look up here. And also to the Gentiles, which, by the way, this is like the epitome of Acts 1 and verse 8 being lived out. It's right there. And also to the Gentiles, that all must repent of their sins and turn to God. and prove they have changed by the good things they do. So we are so afraid theologically is going sliding the scale to this side and think it's a works-based religion. I got to go, 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 try, me, me, me. I got to try harder. That we go to the other end of the spectrum where we're the lazy slob on the couch trampling the grace of God underfoot as grace perverts. So we're either on this side where we're a workaholic, or over on this side, a lazy slob just waiting. Well, I'm on the couch praying. God doesn't see fit to move me, so I'm going to keep Cheetos in my belly. I'm going to keep watching Netflix until God sees fit to get me off of this couch. And prove they have changed by the good things they do. Is God doing a good work in you? If good things are not happening, if there's not fruit, it's not, the problem is that you have the wrong tree. You have not been grafted into his tree. And that's where you cry out and plead, Lord, help me. Melt my heart of stone. I can't do heart surgery. It's like someone having a heart attack just going, help me, right? They don't pat themselves on the back like, man, I cried out for help. God, yay. It's like, man, I can't. I mean, I thought for sure I was a goner. I'm safe. This is amazing. Some of you, though, you think, man, I'll be okay. I will settle things in court with God. I'll be fine someday when I meet God in the sky, when I meet him in the courtroom. I'll be okay. I'm a good talker. I'll get out of this. I'll be okay. I want you to write this down. If you do not settle things out of court with God, which, by the way, you're out of court. Did you know that right now? You're out of court. It's very interesting. In the Benton County Jail, when I was sharing this, they were understanding it. They're out of court. They're not. I'm not a prosecuting attorney. I'm not a defense attorney. I'm not the judge. I'm trying to get them to meet the defense attorney, Christ, and settle things out of court, because once you're in court, it's too late. And I'll prove it to you, Hebrews 9 and verse 27. And just as it is appointed for man to die once, and after that comes judgment. If we do not settle things out of court through Christ, we will be lost. What I've found is we are very polite people to our face. We will nod. We'll even say amen. We'll say nice sermon. We'll say, well, I'll check out your gospel community, but we don't ever show up. We can't, these days, we can't even return a text. We can't return, I mean, we live what we really believe. You'll keep doing what you believe. Do you believe the God of the universe can work and move in you? Why do we need this passage as the worship team leads us in communion? Listen, we are living on borrowed time, and yet we think we have somehow earned this life that we live. Somehow, I'm alive because, you know, I'm a pretty nice person. Here's the passage's answer. There is a second death for those who don't know Christ. This is why we need to settle things out of court. Therefore, let us repent and find real life. Let's turn to him. This is a great, incredible thing that we can turn to him and find new life, find it that it's abundant life. 1 Thessalonians 5:9, for God has not destined us for wrath, but to obtain salvation through Jesus Christ. God does not want you to stay here. That's why he's calling to you right now. He doesn't want you to stay on this dead tree. He wants to get you and graft you into newness of life. He is the tree of life. He says, I am the vine and you are the branches. We need to abide in him. So God has given us a new destiny. He has changed the course of outcome through Christ. This is incredible news that we could not save ourselves, but through the power of the Holy Spirit and his gospel, he draws us to have faith and grace, which is an incredible thing. Amen. Amen. Let's pray. Jesus, help us right now.